And now, it is finally time. I don't know if we'll be able to finish this now, because I remember Elizabeth's story being rather short. Within the endless darkness are scattered countless bright lights like a nebula. But those lights are not stars. Each one is a light is the light of life, the gleam of man's soul. This is the world held inside people's hearts, a place where every human's consciousness is connected to what can be traced as to their origin. Every memory since the dawn of man, and even those on the ladder of its evolution, slumber here. Some think of this place as a sea, and they may be correct. Depending on how deep you go, you may see this world's endless landscapes and innumerable faces. Where I stand now is one of its furthest depths, a domain that has existed before life became sentient or even took form. Here, there is only the darkness of death and the radiance of life. I come here at times for a very important objective. Suddenly, a patch of darkness surges and undulates. The pitch-black substance swells with a tar-like consistency and quickly takes the shape of a giant arm.
My, it's rather stout compared to before.
Meet Erebus, everybody! Just as good and evil are products of a man's heart, there is a negative force here in the sea of souls that tempts man to corruption and destruction. Though one person's malice may amount to little, there are billions of people in the world. It's actually common and for monsters capable of destroying mankind to develop without anyone realizing. This is one of them. Though it only has an arm at first, it quickly develops into an enormous human-shaped torso. Even in this space, where up and down are fluid, its resentment-filled roar causes the air to shake. The monster raises an enormous arm toward the heavens. Its destructive power could tear down mountains. But it suddenly stops. Something is blocking its movement. I am, to be precise. You might think I'm nowhere on the scene. In truth, even the monster may be thinking that. But I'd like to direct your attention to the fingertip at the end of the giant arm. Closer. Even closer than that. I keep going closer, all the way to the index finger. Yeah, for the record, Erebus is friggin' huge.
Do you see me now? Have I forgotten to introduce myself? My name is Elizabeth.
Breaking the fourth wall. I fix my gaze upon two lights that seem to be the monster's eyes, but it twists away, trying to resist.
Do you wish to behold death that much?
I grab the monster's index finger. And in one motion, I flip its immense body and throw it into the air. Think about that. Her body's the size of the thing's friggin' index finger. Or rather, smaller than that. And she tosses it with the whole thing with no effort. The monster cries out in agony, and the area quakes again. This is the basic strength of an elevator attendant of the Velvet Room.
Oh dear! It seems it won't be easy for one of this size.
They are notoriously the hardest bosses in Persona. Elizabeth has been eating her Wheaties.
I cannot damage the world of everyone's hearts, and I hesitate to make a scene in the real world either. Time for a change of scenery.
I opened the elegant grimoire in my hand. A large blue magic circle forms behind the throne monster, swallowing the gargantuan figure. I follow it in. Continual turbulent streams of light and darkness blow past the monster and myself. Eventually, I speak up.
We'll soon reach our destination.
Another magic circle appears in an altogether different kind of void and the one than the one we came from. I'm trying to see if I can read if I can read those symbols. If I can read those the letters there, like it's Greek lettering though I'm pretty sure it's Latin. I think it's the four elements because I recognize Terra, which is Latin for Earth. Another magic circle appears in the altogether different and kind of black void than the one we came from. The monster is spat out of there when it collides with the surface. A tremendous cloud of dust rises. I emerge from the magic circle, second, and rise into the air. On the horizon beyond the monster, I can see a deep blue sphere. She's just on the moon now. Yes, this is the moon.
I had promised to show you death. Your fate is in the cards.
And she wasn't kidding. She friggin' summons Thanatos. A figure appeared behind me, bearing several coffins. For people who don't know, Thanatos is the god of death in Greek mythology. Like, he is essentially the Grim Reaper of Greek mythology.
The god of death, Thanatos. What do you think?
The light of the stars shines off its drawn swords and gleam bewitchingly.
Was it to your liking? Well then, farewell.
It flings the sword down at the monster's head. Against its fearsome size, the sword is barely larger than a needle. But the sword's merciless sharpness pierces far beyond the blade's length. The monster's body slices apart like web paper. With a final death cry, the monster slowly dissolves and evaporates into black mist. And I can tell you this right now, that thing's no joke. A deafening silence returns to the area. To break the silence, a tune plays on my lips. I create another magic circle in the air and step through it. I shouldn't remain long in this world without any real objective. This is not the world I belong in, after all.
My master has a large nose.
For the record, yes, it is canonically stated that this is the anthem of the Velvet Room. I was once a resident of the Velvet Room and served its master. And you'll see here the Velvet Room looks different from the one we were in in Yu's story. That's because it's like the Velvet Room's appearance changes depending on the person. And in Persona, normally to depict their current trajectory through life. With Persona 4, it was a car. With Persona 3, it was an elevator. And in Persona 5, it is a prison, because in that game, your life has been ground to a halt. The dark blue clothing I still wear is from that time. All the residents have their roles, but they are also on a journey. We help our guests grow as people, and through the help we offer, we come to understand the ultimate question. It's the fundamental question of who are we?
Thinking back on it, I spent so many days like that for such a long time. I had thought that it would be impossible to change.
But 2 years ago, I finally reached my answer. One's identity cannot be sought out, but I must be forged for oneself. It's something you build little by little. People call it the freedom to do so potential, and by mastering it, people develop their unique identities. That is the understanding I came to. So it seems to me I should believe in my own potential and wander in pursuit of my desire. It wasn't a hard conclusion to come to. That's why I abandoned my assigned role and departed on my long journey. I have a set of objective for myself. To defeat the monster I fought a moment ago once and for all. I vanquished it then, but that is only temporary.
Surely resurrect within the year again. And I'll go through today once more.
That monster was born from the twisted wishes arising from the lack of substance in people's lives. It slowly stagnates and seeps out. If this is life, then bringing on death. Desires like that are what gives it power. And that giant black arm is to free death from its prison. It can never be left to act on its claim, on its aims. But as long as people continue to wish as they do, the foul feeling will congeal and it will revive endlessly. To truly defeat the monster would be to change the very souls of the people. That cannot be done no matter how much one improves their skill in battle. I do not currently know how this goal can be attained. It may be that no one in this world knows yet. Some new and unknown miraculous power will most likely be required. That is why I wish to travel as far and wide as I can to broaden my horizons. Since I have only interacted with the guests of the room, I'm sure the scope of my knowledge is far inferior to a single human's. But there are infinite places for me to explore. I'll travel to each one and satisfy my curiosity.
Now, that's why I have come here. A double check on the danger scale situation that I just recently discovered.
He was just like, oh, I better check on this. I placed my hands on my hips and what I believed to be standing firm. Before me is what seems to be a replica of a building in the real world.
Since multiple Persona users gathering. It's once in a blue moon that one discovers a place like this.
For a second, I thought she said Persona.
I'm sure I can learn some interesting things here, or something along those lines.
Persona, the other side of the coin.
In any case, I, Elizabeth, can scarcely keep myself from getting involved.
For someone with a physical form to step into the realm of the mind would be for them to enter an even more abstract place than the Velvet Room. Normally, it would be impossible, and even if it were, it would be very dangerous without a firm will. For it to occur at all is intriguing enough, but on top of that, these people are mainly Persona users. And not just one or two. There's no denying that something truly extraordinary is happening here. Broadened horizons aside, I can't resist taking a closer look. When I get closer, I see the nameplate reading Yasogami High School at what seems to be the main gate.
This building, is it a school?
The school building before me looks aged as I narrow my eyes.
It's somewhat old-fashioned compared to the school I have experience with, but it has its charms as well. This is what they call animalist aesthetic. Animalist? Bestial? Anyway, something along those lines.
Yeah, this is a common tick with Elizabeth. There are bizarre decorations as far as the eye can see inside the building. Was the school always thus adorned?
The fabled school festival I've heard tell of?
Sure, let's go with that.
A festival is where one toys with the lives of goldfish in a scandalous game. One can also enjoy a combat simulation with close-range shooting tests using sniper rifle fire into the interior of stalls.
I don't think you get those in school festivals, Elizabeth.
Ooh, I'm starting to get excited.
Looking up, I spy a large sign and in vibrant colors.
Grand Prix. Could this be a fighting tournament? This isn't why the Persona users are gathering, is it?
No sooner do my suspicions arise than I sense the first presence within the school and run towards it. Come, Challenger. I wave my arms about in anticipation. But something seems a bit odd.
That lady over there, she not a Persona user? Regardless of that, I sense something out of the ordinary.
When I close my eyes, I can tell that while she may appear to be a human girl, something about her is amiss. I sense an unnatural disconnect from her memories and consciousness seen in most people.
Is she truly human?
Now that I'm here, I can sense powerful combatants gathering one by one. If such power were to be used to its fullest in clashes of skill, the result could be life-threatening. This place is not meant for such a girl. If she were to be drawn into this, then in the worst case scenario,
my old self, when I only lived to play out my role, I would leave her be. But I am different now.
I make my way towards the girl. As I approach her, I begin to hear voices. It seems that she is calling herself the student council president. I stride down to the end of the hallway where she is walking directly into her view. The girl gives me a slightly questioning look, but no more. She comes towards me guilelessly.
Hey, excuse me. You got some reason to be at our school?
Up close, I can tell at once. There's no doubt that this girl is not human. Yet she seems to be under that impression. The original residents of this place seem to believe that she is as well. But of course, that is impossible. The disconnect I sensed earlier must be related.
Someone have tampered with her memories and psyche?
No matter how unusual her circumstances, such extreme gaps in awareness are no mere figments of the imagination. It's possible, but normally, though, as with a distorted view of reality, have equally distorted emotions. I do not sense that in her. Her emotions are in balance. Only her memory is an awareness fall short, like a court de ballet falling behind and a soloist. I fix my gaze on the girl before me once again. If she did not come here of her own will, then the events may be more sinister than I imagined.
Are you sure this is how things should be? Huh? What are you talking about?
Oh, are we getting a repeat of the fight we did with Labrys's story? I mean, it makes sense.
I am a wanderer who only stopped here because I sensed great power gathering. I am in no position to give advice, but... this place will soon be caught in a bit of a fracas. If you continue to avert your eyes from everything, I think it will have an impact on your life in the near future. My life? What you choose is up to you, but I believe there are factors preventing you from making the right choices at the moment. I couldn't bring myself to just stand by and watch as you lost your life before my eyes.
I think this is exactly what she said in Labrys' story.
That is why I came to you, so I could give you one last chance.
She has most likely forgotten who she is. I sense something shining, slumbering in deep in our heart. It's the glow of a bond. No one who has been in residence of the Velvet Room could mistake it for anything else. Before she forgot herself, she must have had strong feelings about someone or had made a promise to them. But I'll leave it to her to remember what it was. I hold out my Persona Compendium as if handing it to the girl and open its pages. Life streams from it and washes over her. The light dispels the girl's false image, the illusion that made her seem human, though she is not.
Huh? What is this?
Her true form is revealed as a gleaming mechanical body. Her arms look as if steel plates are covering them. The girl frantically pulls at them to try and tear them off.
It won't come off. What gives? My, what a robotically cool body. It is apparently meant for battle. Hey, you! What did you do to me? Nothing in particular. Well, considering that you are meant for battle, I shall briefly be your opponent.
Oh, God.
During that time, why not think back about who you are? Huh? My opponent?
Most likely, I will not get through to her with words alone. Only by being forced into a confrontation will she finally be able to understand. She already knows how to use the steel limbs, which she supposedly never seen before. What is this music? You see how broken she is. And yeah, those moves with Thanatos she was doing, they cost SP, which is why she has a passive where she gains SP every turn as time goes on. Not every turn. I had still in FGO mode. The girl collapsed powerlessly.
I
I used a soft touch during the battle. She should have sustained no injuries. Probably. Still, the girl does not stand back up. Apparently due to mental rather than physical stress. Her own arms and legs had turned metallic. Yet in the heart of battle, she was able to use those foreign appendages with ease. If she truly thought herself to be human, that would have come as quite a shock.
That should be enough. I'm sure you realize now that you are not human. There must have been an important promise that could only be kept in that guise. That must have been your reason for living. Whether it's worth losing that or not, I ask that you give it serious thought.
An important promise? My reason for living?
Her potential will become unlocked through self-reflection. That was how it happened for me as well.
It seems the tumult of trials is about to begin. In which case, I bid you good luck.
Oh.
I close the compendium in my hand, and the warm pages rustle as they meet. By the time it's shut, I'm already far away from the girl. In my absence, the illusion is again in place, giving her the appearance of a human once more. She may consider what happened to be a daydream, and that is quite all right. My intention was to give her an opportunity to awaken to the truth. What she eventually decides is up to her. But that aside, there's something else on my mind. The girl I fought looked human, but wasn't. It is rare for even one such as I, with an unimaginably long lifespan, to meet someone like her. Yet she is the second such person I have known. The other was also a guest of mine once. For those who don't know, I think I mentioned this before, but Aegis is the main character of the playable epilogue of a Persona 3 FES, and she was a guest of the Velvet Room at the Velvet Room. She too resembled a human girl. I can sense her power somewhere here as well. Most likely, she's here for reason and having to do with the girl I met.
An intriguing event, more so than I had first imagined.
Though I came here on a mere whim, this trip may be unexpected fruit. Perhaps I'll discover something important. My interest peaked even more now. I decided to go further in. When I do, the bustle of voices reaches my ear. Is that a cheer? One of the monitors nearby turns on after the cheers dies down. It's showing a girl in a school uniform.
Ladies and gentlemen, is everyone ready? It's time to get our program started. I, Reset, will be your commentator. Please hold your applause. Oh, you're too kind. You're too kind. Well, with things starting to heat up now, the general has a few words for you. The mic's all yours, sir.
Next, a person who seems to be the host takes the girl's place. Actually, person may be incorrect. That intriguing and fluffiness and tantalizingly round body. Are you planning to eat Teddy?
Well then, I'm proud to announce the opening of our very own P1 Grand Prix! Presenting the manliest of all men!
This is more of a to-do than I thought.
I keep watching as the video with some upbeat music plays.
Is this an introduction to the contestants?
A number of girls and boys are introduced at a steady pace. I haven't seen any of their faces before, but they appear to be Persona users. Each of them is tagged with a mocking epithet.
The carnivore who's discarded womanhood, the blood-curdling beefcake emperor, the sister complex kingpin. Are these signs of their willingness to cast aside their pride and pursue victory? I wonder if they're not casting aside a little too much. This is a rather novel idea.
There's no denying that those with power are gathering in here for the tournament. The video comes to a close. Since I came here on my own whim, I'm obviously not featured in it. How unfortunate. I catch myself pouting my lips.
Should I officially enter this as well? Oh, but if the manliest of all men are the ones called for, I cannot participate. Then again, I distinctly spotted a woman or two in the introductory video. Then I shan't concern myself with such trifling details. I shall soldier on.
The next time the host appears on the monitor, I'll make my entreaty. If he turns me down, then I shall resort to force. Very good. I love how she distinctly Elizabeth is in control here. My mind made up, I begin my walk through the school. Battles, battles, battles. Oh, where might I find a battle? I look into a window nearby.
Oh, aha! My. The host himself is before my eyes.
Before I realize it, I'm already in motion.
Pardon my dynamic entrance.
Someone's here!
Looking around, I see a piano and portraits of famous composers lining the wall. I see, this must be what they call a music room. Are you going to be the one to tell Elizabeth? No. If so, where did you like your remains buried? Yeah, woe to those who go against Elizabeth.
Please forgive me for startling you.
Ooh, who are you, miss?
Elizabeth and all her instant death spells.
Be it one who is currently utterly neglecting her duties.
An elevator attendant? I don't believe it. I'm having culture shock.
God damn it, Teddy.
I wish Junessa's elevators had such beautiful attendants, too.
Excuse me, but may I ask your name?
Teddy! Hadoi!
I'm sorry. Would you mind repeating that in human language?
I was saying it normally. Teddy is my name, and I'm a proud bear.
I see. Teddy Bear. You have a rather creative flair to your appearance.
I wish you'd say cute instead. Though hearing a pretty lady like you say so makes my heart skip a beat.
Watching him, I cannot restrain my curiosity any longer and prod at his soft fur with abandon.
Huh? What are you doing?
This seems to lack ventilation. How does he breathe in there? Oh, there's a zipper.
Stop! I'm ticklish! Oh no! No opening! You're embarrassing me!
Oh, please forgive me. Curiosity almost killed the bear.
That's assuming there are any remains left. She doesn't begin to lay on you into a pure nothingness. Yeah, pretty much. Whether or not you get buried, it depends on whether or not your ashes survive.
Huh? What were you planning on doing to me? You're even a tougher customer than the kids at the food court, miss.
When I step away, Teddy Bear lightly smooths over his fur to try and regain his composure.
I had forgotten what I originally meant to ask because of your fine coat of hair. Teddy Bear, though I am a woman, I wish to partake in this Grand Prix.
Huh? I can't help you with that.
There might not be any atoms left by the time she's done. Yeah.
Oh, but are you not the host shown in the introduction video?
It's all a huge misunderstanding. That guy's an imposter. Won't you hear me out?
Seems he is faced with some kind of dilemma. I decide to lend an ear to Teddy Bear. He animatedly describes his circumstances, but his arms and legs are too short to illustrate his point. His mannerisms are so peculiar that understanding the thing is an uphill battle. But in the end, I grasp the basics.
So you realized that something was amiss and came wandering in here yourself to investigate. But you fell into the imposter's trap and couldn't do a thing until a moment ago. You have my deepest sympathies.
Do I really? Anyways, everyone else is on the contestant list while I get the cold shoulder!
Is that so? Then, since we are both outcasts, let us participate of our own accord.
Our own?
May I request a match from you?
That makes no sense at all! What do you mean? Ooh, maybe a hot and heavy struggle with all kinds of clinches and holds?
A one-on-one battle to the extreme.
That makes no sense! Wait a second! You look a lot stronger than me, miss!
You have no idea, Teddy!
Oh, don't be so modest.
No, I'm really not!
I'm very sorry, but the deadline for submitting a forfeit notice has expired.
Rip, Teddy!
You're not sorry at all! There are things I can't do, you know! Oh, but on the other hand, if I can try scoring with you later, I might rethink this.
Scoring? I do not understand that, but if that is your stipulation, why, I accept.
Oh, you accept? Woohoo! I'm ready to go whenever you are.
God damn it, Teddy.
That is, if you're still alive after. Well then, here goes. Your fate is in the cards.
And thus this was the last anyone ever saw of Teddy. Yeah, I have seen the chat for Teddy. I take my fighting stance. Ah, settling matters through a show of force is simple, straightforward, and so beautiful. Well, that didn't work. He got a lot closer than I thought he would, I'm not gonna lie. Everyone then rip in the chat for Teddy. With an exaggerated groan, Teddy Bear collapses, or rolls down to be more precise.
Teddy Bear, you truly are an intriguing creature.
Hearing this, Teddy Bear springs to his feet.
Are you interested in me?
Though you aren't human, you fight against your fate and wish to be with humans. I have witnessed one other case who bore such a fate in the past.
Huh?
You made a choice and decided how you wish to live. That is marvelous, Teddy Bear.
Marvelous? Me? Does that mean you're still okay with me trying to score with you?
That is not what it means.
Teddy Bear loses his balance for some unknown reason and falls over. She shot Teddy down and she doesn't even know who she did.
Shoot down my attempts reminds me of Yuki-chan.
Yuki-chan, is this an acquaintance of yours?
Yuki-chan is a very precious friend of mine.
You have friends.
Actually, everyone who is in that video are my friends. But forgive them for having all the fun. I'll make them buy me a tasty treat for this.
I see. May I ask you something? Who would you consider the strongest among your friends?
Well, Sensei, of course. He's the manliest of all men!
If Danny, you're alive, be thankful for that and shut up!
Sensei, if I recall correctly, that is the name of a governing class within a school, wielding the power of life and death over its students.
I think you got kind of the wrong idea where the teacher's job is.
Yes, that does indeed sound like the name of a strong warrior.
Sensei's our leader.
F's in the chat. He sounds strong, but he seems to be unconnected to the former guest I'm searching for. But as Teddy Bear speaks of his friend called Sensei, he wears a beaming expression. They must be connected with a truly strong bond. Inwardly, I am surprised. Though he is adorable, this Teddy most likely is to be something similar to a shadow. I am very curious about anyone who could form a bond with such a being. Think about it that way makes me interested in him as well.
Oh, that was quite helpful. Thank you.
Once the tournament's over, you should come hang out at Juness sometime.
Actually, you know what? We are playing Elizabeth, aren't we? So, why not go with the goddess form?
Juness?
It's a place where Don Yosuke and I work.
Don Yosuke?
It's huge. You can eat food there. And they have candy, toys, and sexy bikinis, too.
Good lord.
What a paradise on Earth. It seems there is still much I do not know about in your world. Well then, if you'll excuse me, I must get going now.
Be careful!
I bow politely. Teddy Bear waves back with a big smile. Now, though I decided to participate on my own, how should I proceed from here? I don't have a good understanding of this building. Or of this building's layout, after all. I think I forgot to do the thing. Yes, I did. I try going in and out of the building to test various paths, but I don't get anywhere.
It may have come to this.
I rear back my head and inhale as deeply as I can. And then
the next opponent. No one heeded my call. I suppose repeating that line isn't enough.
My shoulders slag slightly as I concentrate on the area nearby. I sense an unexpected presence.
There is someone closer by than I had expected. What a reunion this will be. I'm starting to feel tingly.
Oh, we're going to do the Aegis fight, aren't we? The Aegis fight, aren't we? There is no need for me to search for an opponent, since one is already nearby. I trace the presence and proceed down the hallway. Then I reach what appears to be an entryway. I can hear what sounds like voices quarreling. One of the voices is Teddy Bear, or rather the sham host General Teddy. As I move forward, I find myself breaking into a run. Soon afterward, the voice's owner enters my field of vision. Just as I thought. That unmistakable figure, she's a guest I hosted in my life as a resident. If I recall correctly, her name is Aegis. Upon closer inspection, she is aiming her weapon at General Teddy on the monitor. Ah, if I don't act now, the match will start without me. I must prevent General Teddy from speaking for the time being until my business is completed. Again, before I realize it, I am already in motion.
Oh, no. Pardon my bold entrance. Huh? Oh, the monitor's completely shattered. Who would do such a thing?
She's not my favorite character, but I kind of love Elizabeth.
A strange intruder has shown up.
I mean, she's just fun.
Oh my. I thought we were having a touching reunion. How unfortunate that you would refer to me as a strange intruder. A reunion? I don't recall ever meeting anyone so odd. She who governs power. Does that ring any bells for you? Huh? Wait. Are you the one I met in that blue room, then? Your entrance just now was very different from how I remembered your behavior, so I didn't recognize you. But you're... Aridinus, son. No. Elixir? In any case, I never dreamed that I'd meet you here. That goes for myself as well. It's been a long time since I saw you.
Yeah, he references to the answer. Yep, the answer is indeed canon.
But why are you here? What about your duties of governing power? I am currently in gross abandonment of my duties.
The way she says that.
That was a very straightforward answer. Considering the circumstances here, I'd like to test your strength as well.
I excitedly flipped through the pages of the compendium.
Please, wait a moment. Does that mean you wish to fight me? From what I've heard, in certain cultures in your world, one lets one's fists do the talking.
Elizabeth, you should be barred from that rule because you would kill anyone with just a sneeze.
Perhaps you could think of it as a sporty, modern, and extreme way of greeting one another.
Good lord.
I don't understand at all. You seem to have become strong beyond all recognition. I'd like to see your power for myself to broaden my horizons. Will you grant my shameless request?
I still don't understand. But does this mean your wish will be fulfilled if I agree to fight you? If that's really what you want, will you mind if I don't hold back?
I couldn't ask for anything more. I, Elizabeth, will fight you with all the strength at my disposal. Now, let us begin.
Settling matters through a show of force is simple, straight. Pardon me. I said that once already.
Persona! Persona! Time for no! Functions shutting down!